In the cold light of day, I suppose it would have been classified as stealing from Woolworth. I was only 7 at the time. I was under some stress and pressure, and after all, in my book, it was only a replacement. But their end-of-week balances would have been out, and their executives would have been wondering about the broken yellow plastic dog with red ears. Tenby was an annual holiday jaunt in those days. I would go down and see Grandpa and Grandma. They lived in number 8 Trafalgar Road, just next door to the barber shop. They were grandparents on my father's side, and they were very much down below people with a strong South Pembrokeshire accent. I looked forward to a week in Tenby every year. My grandpa, Jimmy Noble, was a genial, lovely man with a big moustache, turned yellow in parts by his heavy smoking, a flat dye cap on his head, and as often as not, wearing a waistcoat, even in warm weather. He was a painter by profession, not an artist, but a painter of houses, being a specialist in graining, using a comb to run through the paint to create a flowing design. Their front door at number 8 Trafalgar Road was magnificent, and one of my regrets is that in later life, I didn't buy that door. By the time I decided to purchase it, the new owners had painted it blue. I did have compensation sometime later from Tenby Golf Club. At a speaking engagement, they presented me with a model of the door, properly grained on a plinth. I still have it. Number 8 Trafalgar Road was an exciting place, with an indoor toilet, a large sailing yacht on top of a cupboard in the bathroom, and a parlour that had a sideboard full of silver cups, won by Grandpa's yachts. Actually, Grandpa had 2 full-size yachts, the Doric and the Elsie, in the harbour at Tenby. They were sailing dinghies, really, but to me they were yachts. They were manned for him by a couple of men in the town, Val and Little Jimmy, and they would race in various competitions and regattas, as well as take the men out for mackerel fishing, as needs arose. I never once sailed in the Elsie. I was a Doric man. Dad and I would often go out fishing for mackerel with Little Jimmy, who had a hump on his back. As I recall, not one of us wore a life jacket. There was no health and safety then. In fact, in a photograph I have at home, I'm seen holding up a small catch of fish, dressed sedately in a non-marine gabardine mac, and wearing a school cap. I was a little afraid of Grandma Noble. She had a slight limp and used a stick. Her hair was tied closely together in a bun with a parting down the middle. She was strict. She didn't take prisoners. I remember one wet day, Mam and I were in the parlour, and we could hear her slowly coming down the stairs, 2 feet and a stick, in a rhythm that gave a clue that this was no messenger of good news. The clonk of the stick opened the parlour door. In she came, holding in her hand something that looked like wet paper. "You better talk to him," she said to my mother. "When he goes to the toilet, he's using too much toilet paper. It's a waste. Train him better." It's odd what children keep in their minds forever, because that was a traumatic moment for me. I've never forgotten it. From that moment on in life, I've always been very frugal with toilet paper. You see, toilet paper was a new experience for me. Toilet paper probably came to Tenby, being a tourist area, a couple of years before Brynaman. Our toilet paper in the toilet at the back was the Daily Herald, hanging on the nail. The posh people cut it into squares. Grandma Noble probably didn't think it through, so she never realised that in my toilet training, she left a scar in my mind about those personal, private, contemplative, Kazi moments. Tenby was a place of adventure for a young boy. It had nooks, crannies, alleys, paths, and steps that took you down to the harbour, to the beaches and caves, to the lifeboat station, and on to take in the views of Caldy Island in the south and of Cosca Rock and Monkstone Point in the north. Oddly enough, many years later, I was told that the merchant's house in Tenby, the oldest house there, I believe, was where the nobles first lived when they came to the town as coastguards. It was then a tenement building, so several families lived there, but it was nice to have it pinpointed as a previous noble home. Another noble abode was the house in the parade near the fire station, which has a sad family history. 4 of my grandfather's siblings died there of typhoid during their teenage years or early 20s when the water supply was contaminated. Many years later, after I had been broadcasting a short while, I was given the treat and honour of being invited to be president of the Tenby Male Choir. It's always a very, very pleasant occasion when we go down to see them perform, or join them for their annual Christmas lunch, which is in January, by the way. That must be something to do with the Pembrokeshire pace of life. There is such a thing as the Pembrokeshire Promise, I'm told, whereby if you ask for something to be done by craftsmen, for instance, it'll always be soon. It's a promise, meaning eventually. With regard to the Tenby Choir, the event I will always remember was when Elaine, Richard and I were invited to join them on a tour to Romania. The BBC agreed that whilst there, I could do some recordings. Romania at the time was a communist regime, and all visitors were regarded with some suspicion. Elaine and I had been undermined somewhat by a gentleman from BBC World Service in London, who was a Romanian, and wanted us to take some packages into the country. "Someone will meet you at the airport or come to your hotel," he said. Add this disquieting approach to the fact that Elaine was a fearful flyer, and you can see that we were not having the best of possible preparations for the trip. On the day we were due to leave Cardiff Airport, this tired Ilyushin aircraft came in from Taron Airlines of Romania. A big woman disembarked, dressed in a leather trench coat. She introduced herself as head of security and came up to me. "You are the Presidente, are you not?" I nodded at this vision from a James Bond film. Clearly, she was not sufficiently high in the Communist Party to have had access to a dentist. "You and your wife will sit in the VIP lounge in the back of the plane." Elaine found the back of the plane doubly claustrophobic and was so tense and traumatized that she refused to sit down. She burst into tears, sobbing, "I want to get off." There was no consoling her. So off we got, Richard, Elaine, and myself. The big woman in the trench coat glared and hissed, "If you are getting off of the plane, then your cases must come off too." She quickly organized the pilot, a baggage handler from Cardiff Airport, and myself into a chain gang. While the whole of the aircraft was searched, the cases found, and passed along the line. As I said, Romania as a country in those days was a hard communist regime. The Romanian tour guide would only talk freely to everyone when he was outside any building, or better still, on a mountain. So to the memory I mentioned earlier. I've been putting off the notorious Woolworth incident. When we were on holiday, my mother usually spent some of the week buying presents for my cousins back home in Prynamon. For Cousin John, she'd bought a small yellow plastic dog with a convincing bark if you pushed his backside. He had red ears. I can see him now. One rainy day, I was in the parlour, killing time, when I started playing with a toy canine, and one of his ears came off of my hand. I didn't know what to do. I was desperate, and I had a mind's vision and a fair inclination as to my mother's reaction, so I decided on a bold plan of action. I would take the plastic dog back to Woolworth and change it for another. I walked into the Tenby Woolworth store, found the counter where the dog had been bought, and my luck was in. There were still some for sale. I nervously looked around, found the coast clear, placed the broken dog on the counter, and took another unblemished replacement and walked out. I'm pleased now that I've shared that memory with you, because it has been weighing heavily upon my shoulders for years. That unsolved crime can now be scrubbed off the David Powys police records. Sadly, there's no recompense for Woolworth, because all the stores have closed. How I did it, I don't know. Why I did it, I do know. Even now, when I lie in bed, though, unable to sleep, that incident creeps back into my mind, and the hair stands up on the back of my head. In the cold light of day, I suppose it would have been classified as stealing from Woolworth. I was only 7 at the time. I was under some stress and pressure, and after all, in my book, it was only a replacement. But their end-of-week balances would have been out, and their executives would have been wondering about the broken yellow plastic dog with red ears.